here with Rick. We're at a self-harm conference and Rick has been talking about the Mind and Body program. Can you just introduce a little bit about what the program is, who you are, what you do?
Yeah, sure. So Mind and Body is a program delivered by Ad Action, and we are commissioned at the moment in Kent and Cornwall to work with young people around self-harm. So we work with 13 to 17 year olds who are either involved in self-harming behaviours or might be deemed vulnerable to them. I guess the core of the program is really delivered in group sessions. So we have one-to-ones initially with young people just to check their levels of risk and how appropriate they might be for that type of program, because it really needs to be more early intervention. But from that point on, young people then take part in 8 group sessions in total, where they can hopefully talk in a really safe space, maybe for the first time, about mental health and maybe about some of the triggers for self-harm and how to manage those.
Why did you choose group intervention?
To be honest, we didn't necessarily choose it. It started to choose itself, because when we started the program back in 2014, we piloted the program in both one-to-one and group settings.
Mm-hmm.
But the feedback that we had from young people was that they really liked the groups, and to hear from others, to hear from their peers,
mm-hmm.
and get that comfort that they weren't the only people going through these things was hugely powerful. And so for that reason, it's become kind of the real selling point of the program. You have to manage it very carefully. So when we are putting groups together, I guess what we have to make sure is that you don't have different levels of risk within the same groups.
Can you say a bit more about that?
Yeah, so what we wouldn't want is maybe somebody who is involved in self-harm and has maybe been for quite a long period of time, and their level might be at quite a high level of risk.
Yeah.
You wouldn't want somebody there in the same group who is maybe at a lower level, struggling a little bit with anxiety, who might be a bit more impressionable, and where things could potentially, you might be almost bringing their behaviours up,
right.
if that makes sense. So we're very cautious about having people on the programme where there is sort of complex risks, where there is sort of enduring behaviours that are quite embedded.
And how many people would be in a group?
We'd look at 5 or 6 as the average, so you've got a bit of safety in numbers,
yeah.
But also it allows enough opportunity for people who want to speak.
Yeah.
To have their voice heard.
And how long does each group run for?
So the sessions are an hour,
yeah.
And the way that the program works is after the initial one-to-one, they will then take part in 6 group sessions over roughly the period of a month,
okay.
So maybe 1 or 2 sessions a week. We then have another one-to-one after that first block of sessions, and then there's a gap for maybe 2 months,
yeah.
And over that time the idea is that the young people can sort of employ those new strategies and techniques.
Stuff
that they've learned in the groups.
Yeah.
They can hopefully manage themselves
yeah.
for a period. They come back together for 2 final review and reflection sessions, see how they're getting on, what's working, what maybe could they do better, sharing ideas again between themselves, and then we have an exit one-to-one. And I guess what's been the core success is that we've seen that improvements take place from the first one-to-one to the second one, but even more so at the exit.
Wow, so they're not even receiving the intervention anymore, they're just employing those
strategies.
Yeah,
so they've had just 2 sessions in the space of
yeah.
maybe 2 to 3 months,
yeah.
But because they've learned the different ways of managing triggers to improve communication, all of those strategies, either themselves or with those peers who are in the group,
yeah.
The outcomes at the end are even better.
And can you explain a bit more about the actual content of the group sessions? So what are these kids actually learning? What are they doing?
Yeah, so the first session is really very general. So it might be exploring mental health just as an overarching topic, and how people feel that they are able to speak with either their peers about things, to speak with friends, to speak with family. Are there some topics that they think are quite taboo? As the programme goes on, you maybe start to look a little bit more at their individual behaviours.
Yeah.
Again, not going to the levels that would be required in the one-to-ones,
mm-hmm.
but looking maybe at some basic triggers and how to manage those triggers, so positive distractions and diversions.
Yeah.
They share ideas around that. There's a lot of stuff about communication.
Yeah.
But it's all geared towards empowering them to manage themselves in a more positive way, rather than relying on a practitioner, I suppose. I think one of the core things that we've found from the research is that young people are able to do that, and it's great for themselves, but what they've also got is then a role in supporting others.
Yeah.
And so if you have that transition from somebody who's maybe never spoken previously about you know, struggling with mental health,
yeah,
to being in a place where they're actually a support mechanism for other people, that's a massive step.
Yeah. And what happens after this finishes? Because surely these young people become quite close and they are quite a good support network for each other. Does that continue beyond?
In some schools, yeah, it definitely does. So we know that some of them might have continued meetings in schools where, like, the pastoral teams have allowed them to, okay, you can meet in this room and just keep things going. Maybe they do art projects together or something like that.
Yeah.
Others maybe just, you know, it might be a WhatsApp group or something where they can just link in and they have that support. And it can be quite informal, I suppose, in that it's just that, you know, they pass each other in the corridor and they just have a little check-in, and just to know that they're, you know, in somebody else's thoughts, that that's a really powerful thing.
That's really nice.
Mm.
And what about the person who leads the group? Like, what kind of person can lead this kind of group, and what are the measures that you have to put in place to make sure that they're kind of, you know, safe and well prepared and looked after?
So we've got, in terms of the practitioners, we've got a real range. So some who have sort of come from mental health specialist backgrounds,
mm-hmm.
but a lot of our workers haven't. So they might have come from pastoral teams, maybe sort of working with other vulnerable groups.
Mm-hmm.
The core thing that we look for in any worker is that they can engage with a young person, and there's somebody that a young person would feel comfortable talking to.
So that's more important than their kind of, you know, great long CV. You're looking for someone who kind
Yeah, it's really hard to learn how to talk to a human being, I think.
Yeah.
If they have that as a natural skill, obviously there's all the induction work that goes with it. There's the training package. All the practitioners have regular clinical supervision on a one-to-one, on a group basis. There's all of that professional development as well that we'd put in place for them. What you can't really learn, though, you can always build on them, but I think those natural engagement tools are very difficult. And we're lucky that we've got, in each area, we've got great staff teams who are passionate about what they do and are getting fantastic outcomes with the young people that they're working with.
I'm thinking about people who are watching this who maybe might not have access to the Mind and Body programme but might be thinking about setting up something similar themselves on a local basis. What would be your kind of, I don't know, do's and don'ts?
The do's is, I think, thinking about evidence base, which might sound like a really dull thing to say, but I think it's really important on a topic which you do need to handle very carefully,
mm-hmm.
that you're not going in there with the best of intentions, but perhaps causing more harm than doing good. So so it's about, you know, you've got things like the Anna Freud Centre have got a good list of evidence-based programmes.
Mm-hmm.
Mind and Body's listed on the CAPE repository, the Centre for Analysis of Youth Transitions. So there is a lot of stuff out there. Obviously, you know, I'm a fan of Mind and Body, but I'm slightly biased. But there are lots of programs out there that show how to do evidence-based interventions. I guess mentioning things like the, you know, the CYP Mental Health Coalition, I'm sure would be another good starting point for people. But I would say, don't be afraid to give young people a space to talk.
Mm-hmm.
Don't worry too much about, you know, you mentioned the idea of contagion, and actually, if you speak to a young person about self-harm, suddenly they're going to start doing it, or everybody else will. I think as long as you are carefully managing it and you're checking in with them, they have their own supervision to make sure that they are safeguarded and what they're doing is appropriate. Then we really need to encourage open discussion about mental health, and group settings, we have found out, are a great way of doing it.
So you're basically encouraging, but making sure that people do it within kind of safe parameters.
Yeah. And if anybody wants to get in touch with me about how we work, then I'm always very happy to sort of drop them an email.
Great. We'll put links to the programme all down below. And who can actually access the programme? Because some people watching this could access.
So at the moment we're commissioned in Cornwall in Kent.
Yeah.
We've piloted the programme successfully in Lancashire, and we're looking at building it up there. We're now at a stage, to be honest, where the programme has been evidence-based.
Yeah.
We would like to move it into other areas. So for any commissioners watching, do get in touch. But for those young people, if you just go onto AdAction's website, Google AdAction Mind and Body, you'll be able to find our details on
that. Okay, we can put that all in the video details as well. Great, well, thank you ever so much.
Thank you.
Good luck with, I don't know, I'm rubbish at ending videos. I don't know, maybe we just wave and smile, just hands.
Bye.